Hey everybody, it's Norm from Tested, and welcome back to Projections, where this week we're going to talk about hardware, specifically HTC's new Vive Cosmos. I just got back from demo time with the Cosmos. I got to use it for about an hour and wanted to share some of my impressions with you about our time with it, because it is HTC's new flagship consumer desktop VR headset, replacing the original HTC Vive. The Vive Pro, the Vive Pro I are still going to be available for enterprise customers, but for consumers and gamers out there, this is what they're going to be pushing as they phase the original Vive out of the marketplace. Now, some details first. The Vive Cosmos is shipping October 3rd, and it's available for pre-order now at $700. And it's a desktop class VR headset. This is not a competitor to the Oculus Quest. It's not standalone VR. There's no computer or battery built into the headset. It's a tethered headset, much like the Vive Pro, and more akin to now the Valve Index, and also on the Oculus side, the Rift S. In fact, much like the Oculus Rift S, it has now inside-out positional tracking. This is HTC's headset where you don't need to use the SteamVR Lighthouse-based tracking system. In fact, there are no SteamVR lighthouses you place anywhere for the headset or for the new controllers. The headset has six cameras on the front of it. So there are two cameras in the front. There's one pointing up and one pointing down and two on the side. And that's what allows it to then map out the room and give you a sense of where you are in virtual space, as well as where the new controllers are relative to you. The room I used it in was pretty well lit. It had a little bit of daylight coming in, and I'm really curious what this tracking system is going to look like in low light or even in direct IR light, because we know in previous experiences on something like the Oculus Quest, that doesn't work very well in situations where there's bright sunlight. That actually affects the tracking ability of those headsets. Now let's talk about the inside of the headset itself, because the display is also massively changed. The panels they're using now give a combined resolution of 2880 by 1700. That's unlike the 2880 by 1600 pixel resolution that you might see in the Valve Index, in the Vive Pro, and even the Oculus Quest. And also, like the Valve Index, this now is an LCD with an RGB subpixel arrangement. Now, I asked HTC exactly how they ended up on this panel, this resolution, and were these panels the same physical size as the panels on the previous generation headsets? And they were talking really coy about it. All they would say is they wanted to pick a panel that one was LCD with the RGB subpixels. They thought that was really important. And they also wanted to maximize the pixel density, the pixels per degree in the headset. And that's important because the field of view on this headset is exactly the same field of view as you would find on the previous generation HTC Vives. They quote it as about 110 degrees. And for my demo, going from HTC Vive first gen all the way to the Cosmos, yeah, it's that same field of view. The image is definitely more clear, but I, using it, really want to push that headset closer and closer to my eye. I suspect also the panel sizes are exactly the same, and you're going to get maybe more pixel density on the horizontal plane than on the vertical plane. And if you stand still and you really want a pixel peep, yes, you can notice some of that screen door effect. And for me, I noticed maybe more vertical lines than horizontal lines. But when you're in the content, you're in the experiences, and you're in a game, if you're doing any type of movement, you're not going to notice it all. It was very comparable to Valve's Index in that regard. I think the screen quality is really good. It's running at 90 hertz and it does have Fresnel lenses. HTC did say that their Fresnel lenses are now 40% improved compared to the previous generations in terms of some of the visual artifacts. And I didn't really get into scenarios where I'd see high contrast, black areas with bright lights. I couldn't tell if the God rays were there, but in things like the Blue and Sword of Gargantua and Museum of the Realities, I didn't notice any glow effects or glare or God rays. So I'll have to take HTC at their word until we get the review units in to do a formal test and a direct comparison. Now, I said I really wanted to push the headset close to my glasses, to my eyes, and I couldn't because there is no eye relief. Now, eye relief is one of those things that was in the original HTC Vive can pop out the sides and push the lenses and the display closer to your eyes to get slightly bigger field of view. And in fact, the Valve Index lets you do that, push it really close to your eyeballs to get a really much wider field of view, which I really like. But here, instead, they opted for, I think, an ergonomic solution where you can flip up the visor, flip up the headset to see the real world, but at the cost of not being able to then adjust the headset, adjust the display. I found the sweet spot for the lenses. I thought they were pretty close to the original Vive and that it's not a massive sweet spot. You do have to do a little bit of fiddling with the headband. It's a halo style headband to get that sweet spot. But once I was in that sweet spot in something like the blue, I could shift my eyes around and almost see edge to edge and see a pretty clear image and see a lot of blurred pixels until I reach the very edge of that field of view. Ergonomically, it is a halo style strap, which, you know, some people like that. It's easy to tighten. There is a top strap as well to take some of that pressure off your head, and a pretty generous forehead pad that pushes against your forehead to counteract the pressure against the back of your head. In about my hour of game time with the Cosmos, I didn't get fatigued at all. It was pretty comfortable, but I was sweating a little bit by the end of it. There are also built-in headphones on the Vive Cosmos. They look a lot like the Deluxe Audio head strap headphones, although HTC said it's their best headphones they put in a VR headset to date. And in the limited time I had with the demos, it sounded good and pretty loud and isolating. Once I was in there, I couldn't hear what other people were saying. Now, like previous generations of Vive, there is pass-through of sorts with stereo cameras right in front of the headset. So you can double tap the Vive buttons on the controllers, or you can move out to the edge of the chaperone system and the world will fade in, this time in stereo and also in full RGB color. If you have something like the Rift S or the Oculus Quest and you've used their version of pass-through and it's kind of staticky and grayscale, well, here, it's not particularly sharp. I would say it's kind of muddled in terms of the resolution of the cameras, but it is color and it is stereo. I don't think they're doing any type of reprojection system where they're remapping that stereo image on some type of map of the world, so there's no geometry, but it is a quick and comfortable way to see in the outside world, or of course you can flip up the headset as well. One of the interesting things about the Vive Cosmos is potential for upgradability and modularity. So, for example, when we looked inside the headset, we could see on the top right-hand corner, there was a USB-C plug, as well as a 3.5 millimeter jack, which then you could use to plug in your own headphones. The headphones themselves do detach if you want to not use those and use your own. And also the front faceplate of the headset is removable as well, which then takes off two of the cameras, the one pointing up and down. And in the future, HTC is going to release an add-on that lets you then put on a new faceplate that has the Steam VR Lighthouse base trackers. And then that would allow you to use something like the Index controllers, the Knuckles controllers that Valve has released, or even older Lighthouse-based track controllers like the HTC Vive Wands or HTC's own tracking pugs. Now, I was thinking, like, why couldn't you mix and match and use the headset's inside-out tracking with the Knuckles controllers out of the box if you have Lighthouses already? And I think the way Steam ingests tracking information, positional tracking information, you essentially have to use one kind of tracking system for the headset and the controllers. It's for that reason you couldn't plug in a Windows Mixed Reality headset and use Knuckles controllers with that, or the Rift S inside-out tracking for the headset and use Vive Wands or Knuckles controllers. It's using Steam VR Lighthouse-based tracking for everything, headset and controllers, or that third-party tracking system, in this case, that inside-out tracking for the Cosmos and the Cosmos controller. Another upgrade that's gonna come in the future is ability to use the Vive wireless system that's already out for the Vive Pro and the HTC Vive, which will then let the Cosmos be tether-free, getting a wireless signal from the PC. People who have that Vive wireless system today will need to buy a separate attachment that allow it to attach to the Cosmos. Now let's talk about the controllers. Now, if you look at the controllers, they do look a lot like the new Rift S and Oculus Quest style touch controllers. You know, there's that ring on the top, and then there's a thumbstick and trigger and a grip button, but there are a lot of subtle differences. First of all, it's nice and hefty. I actually really like the weight and feel of the Cosmos controllers. And it's heavier because they run off of two AA batteries for each hand as opposed to just one AA battery or rechargeable battery. I know it's debatable whether you like having the rechargeable battery or replaceable battery. I err on liking replaceable batteries because you can just buy rechargeable AA batteries to put in them. But it's interesting that they require two AAs per controller, and from some reports, that will only last about 2 hours of use for each before you have to swap them out. Now, I think it uses more power, not just because it's going to add weight, but because the tracking is based on this light system that's emitted from the top of these rings. So if you look at the rings, inlaid on them is this pattern, and that is the kind of QR code style visual tracking system that the cameras look at to see where the controllers are. Now, in my experience using these controllers, I didn't notice any jitter or drift. And in fact, I was able to move my hands behind my back, pretty far back, and then quickly turn my head and the controller would immediately snap into place. I didn't have to see it drift back into position. So that was pretty good. Although you do lose tracking if you go right behind your head. And of course, if you get really close to the headset. I felt like if you got about 3 inches or so to the front of the headset, that's when you would lose positional tracking and you'd then get rotational tracking. HTC did tell me that they're going to work on software improvements to make sure that they're getting as much information and using as much information as possible to compensate for some of that. But the biggest issue I had was actually with occlusion. When moving one controller in front of the other controller like this, and then I would definitely lose positional tracking on the hand that was behind on the second controller. The front controller will be blocking that. Now, on the controller itself, it does have a thumbstick, and you'll be happy to know that I did test the clickiness of the thumbstick, so you can click it when the thumbstick is pressed in all directions, to all extremes of its range of motion. There are two buttons on the top and also a Vive button underneath it. That's the button that you double click to get the stereo image pass through, but also now to activate the Vive Origin menu to access games in Viveport. And then the trigger is now a two-part trigger. There's a shoulder button as well as a trigger button. And the trigger button does depress and then click. The shoulder button right now is just mapped to the trigger button. There are no games or experiences that I tried that made use of the shoulder button, but I presume if you wanted to map it to a gamepad, for example, and get gamepad controls, you would then also get shoulder button controls. There's also a grip button now, and I was slightly disappointed that that button wasn't an analog button. It was really just a clicky button, so it really has parity with the Vive grip buttons on the side here, but not the full analog grip that you would get on the Oculus Touch. All in all, I don't think there are any big surprises with the Cosmos after reading the specs and then using it. You know, the tracking was about as good as I expected. The image quality with that resolution, with that RGB LCD panel, was good as well. There weren't big ghosting or God ray effects on the lenses, and the field of view was exactly as I expected since they told me it wasn't changed from the previous generations. I am slightly disappointed that it doesn't have that eye relief, but it did fit over my glasses pretty comfortably. I do like the fact that it can pop up with a hinge, and the Halo style headband I felt was comfortable, at least during my time with it. It's available for pre-order now. The price is $700, so it is quite a bit more expensive than the Rift S, for example, but you are getting a much higher image quality display. And for those people who pre-order, they will get a year subscription to Viveport Infinity, which is HTC's kind of all-you-can-play buffet subscription for about 700 VR experiences. It's going to ship on October 3rd, and we're looking forward to getting one in to do a full review and comparison with other VR headsets. But that's our quick impressions of the HTC Vive Cosmos. And if you have questions about the headset that you'd like to see us test in the review, please post them in the comments below and we'll address them in the review. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.